too. I welcome everyone to the Sports Bar Night seminar. Special guests Jessica Trengove and Jeff Risley. Like to thank you all for coming tonight and hope you get something out of it. Some good tips and it helps you in achieving your running goals. Right, first of all, I'd like to introduce myself. My name, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Chris Discombe. I'm the Director of Sports Spinal Health. I'm a physiotherapist. I completed my master's degree in sports physio in 2011, and I did my thesis on core stability training for elite distance runners. My interest in running comes from my participation in the sport. I was a middle distance athlete myself, not the standard of Jess or Jeff, but as you can see from photo two, I was a steeplechaser, 3K steeplechase. And from picture three, that was one of my few wins. And whenever you win, I think you should have a little celebration, a little finger in the air. That's my only joke for the night. All right, a little bit about the clinic. I'm just going to talk about the clinic briefly and about the physios we have here. And then we'll get on to Jeff and Jess. Basically, we're predominantly physiotherapy, clinical Pilates and massage therapy. Next door, you're probably registered there. First of all, Jess is a physiotherapist at the clinic. So Jess has about 5 years experience treating athletes and has a special interest in muscle imbalance and postural dysfunction in runners. So she really loves helping runners achieve their goals. She's been a physio for about 5 years and she's available Monday, Wednesday and Friday at Sports Bar. I'll just talk briefly about the other physios as well. We've got Gary Nichols there, who's been a physiotherapist for 23 years, worked in the AFL system for 15 years with Collingwood and Melbourne. He was head physio at Melbourne for 3 years, the past 3 years, and he was a runner himself as well. So we've got very big running background at the clinic. Alice, who does clinical Pilates at the clinic, and she's a physiotherapist as well. She was a gymnast representing Australia in her early days and turned into a runner as well, competing at the national level. And Mia Stamp, who is our second Olympian at the clinic, who competed at the 1996 Atlanta Olympics in canoeing, and she's very good at treating shoulder injuries from her canoeing days. So two Olympians at the clinic, it's a little bit unusual, but I like it.
All right,
last plug for the night, run group. Some of you guys turned up tonight and had a run, a 30-minute easy recovery run. Jess usually goes off for an easy run at about 4:15 per kilometre. I'm not sure if that's everyone's easy run, but that's Jess's. She leads the group. I'm usually around 5:30 kilometre pace, and there are also runners running at 6:30 plus. So anyone who wants to come, join along. We'd love to have you there. Every Monday night, 6 o'clock. All right, can I ask Jeff and Jess to enter and have a seat? Jessica Trengo and Jeffrey Risley, give them a round of applause. I was expecting Jeff to pull me up on that earlier than tonight, but anyway. All right, first of all, Jess, how are you tonight?
Doing well, thank you. Thanks to everyone who came out to Run Group.
Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about your achievements first of all. Marathon PB is 2 hours, 30 minutes and 12 seconds. Very impressive. You competed in London Olympics and finished 39th place. That was in 2012. A year later, the World Championships in 2011, finished in 11th place. 2013. And in 2014, you finished third at the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow. an amazing achievement. Unbelievable. Now, I've got some photos there of you. I think they're Glasgow photos.
Thanks, Chris.
There's certainly a few emotions there. There's a big smile, which is pretty much your trademark on the left at the top there, or two of the ones. And there's a little bit of crying, I think, going on there as well. The bottom right is you finishing, by the look of it. How did it feel coming down the finishing chute in Glasgow?
And that's when like reality really hit, and I was about to finish in a medal position. And I just, as I was running down that straight, obviously wanted to keep my pace in case the girl was coming up behind me. I hadn't looked behind to see, you know, where anyone else was, but just thought this might be, you know, a once in a lifetime experience. I've got to enjoy the moment right now. So I sort of crossed the line, and one of the Athletics Australia media guys was there with an Aussie flag, and I saw Steve Monteghetti and Michael Shelley, who just won gold, and I sort of got the flag, and yeah, suddenly just the emotion of it all hit, and couldn't hold back the tears, which I've never cried after a run before.
Yeah, you can see it on that one, but I think if any of us finish at a medal place in the Commonwealth Games, we'd probably cry. That's understandable. I've got a little bit of a video here, which is the only video I could find of you finishing in the Commonwealth Games. Have you seen this one before? I'm not 100% sure it is actually, but I'm pretty sure.
You're not sure it is.
We'll give it a go. Has a bit of a weird soundtrack. Who is that guy in the background? What is going on there?
Well, that's from the Beast Marathon. So they started half an hour before us.
Hang on, let me.
Yeah,
that's
cool.
So what was going on there, Jess?
So the men's marathon kicked off at 9. We started at 9:30.
Yeah.
So he'd obviously just had a bit of a tough run.
So you've been one of the guys. That's a very nice way of putting it, Jess. You had a tough run. Okay. Did you like the soundtrack to it as well? Alright, and introducing Jeffrey Risley. Alright, we'll talk a little bit about his achievements first of all. 800 metre PB of 1 minute 44.48, which is 4/100ths of a second off the Australian record. That's pretty close. 1500, 3:32.93, and the 1000 metre PB of 2:16.09, which is the Australian record. So you're in the room today with an Australian record holder, which is pretty amazing. Represented Australia at Beijing and London Olympics, and also went to the Glasgow Games and finished in fifth place. How's it going, Jeff?
Thank you. All right. I've got a video of Jeff as well, and
this is a picture of Jeff, in Glasgow, and that's the finishing line of the final. Play the video. What you didn't see there was the finishing results, and 0.03 of a second off a bronze medal.
Yeah.
I don't know how you respond to that. I mean,
yeah.
How do you feel? Are you really, really pleased with how you ran it at the games, or are you do you feel like you wish you had that, you know, any medal?
Oh yeah, of course that would be good, but I guess at the time I sort of come from, I'd had a history of being able to run really fast, but never been able to compete in a major champs, so I guess on one hand there was relief that, you know, I came fifth, made the final, you know, I did really well, got close, and then obviously backed that up again in the 1500 and got another fifth, so, you know, I competed really well over 5 days, which I hadn't been able to do in the previous sort of 6 major championships, so it was sort of bittersweet, but yeah, no regrets. Still got a few more chances.
Yep. I mean, obviously any of us here would be absolutely stoked with a fifth position and a great run.
There's a psycho, so like, driven like there's no tomorrow, and OCD and probably 80 seconds package, and yeah, we're always trying to be better, so.
Are you speaking for yourself and Jess?
She does the marathon, so she's probably worse. Who wants to run 42k?
Buzzing on the start line, ready to fire.
Caffeine
can sort of reduce your perception of fatigue, so you sort of use it in a different way. But I think
you go out on 2:10 plus.
No, so I think if I actually feel more nervous at the start of a track race because you know you've got to respond like that in a marathon. You sort of have this sense of wanting to feel relaxed and conserve your energy and just work your way into it, so very different events.
Disco, you don't have footage of Jess halfway through the marathon in Glasgow where she's giving thumbs up on the side. Yeah, just still warming into it halfway through.
Did someone give you a coffee halfway through? Or?
No, well, I think I saw my family and got excited and sort of went like that or something, but it looks like I'm doing a little, I'm not sure, but because people take photos out on the marathon course, and every time I see someone that I know, when I'm still feeling okay, I sort of smile and they take a photo, so it looks like I'm just smiling throughout the whole marathon, but it just happens to be.
I might have to try this marathon.
But mostly you feel pretty good when you're on the marathon.
No, well, it really is probably 25 kilometres onwards it starts to, you know, you really start to hurt. I think in the beginning, in the early stages, it's more that anticipation that it's going to hurt, but you're at a pace that feels quite comfortable still. You're trying to set yourself up and use as little energy as possible. I guess I'm thinking about being really efficient in the early stages so that when you do get to that 25 kilometres and beyond and really testing your body, you know, you've got as much energy as possible.
I was going to do this a little bit earlier, but we have a few competitions tonight. ASICS have been good enough to get a sponsor to get some beautiful goodies. First person who can tell me where Jess is from, what state, book, wins a pair of socks. It was actually snowy, I'm afraid, behind you there. But there will be more chances later. Right. Snowy?
She's from South Australia.
There we go, alright. Snowy, where's a pair of socks? What size are you?
That size.
Okay, next slide. Okay, Jess. This is a photo of you, front and centre there, with a little medallion around your neck. Is there a story that goes with this photo?
It's good running kit.
The baggy shorts were in.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a bit of a story. As Jeff was saying, runners sort of, I guess, set themselves pretty high goals, and I put a lot of pressure on myself, I guess, in all areas as a
child. At five?
At five, I got really, really nervous, and I rocked up to school that day ready to run cross country, my first ever race, and chickened out, and I'm not proud of it. I sat on the sidelines with Mum and watched the race because I just had got myself into a nervous mess. And they actually started off and they cut off a huge chunk of the course, and so the school decided they were going to run the race again soon after, and I jumped in and took the win. The others would have been exhausted, so a bit of a victory. I got in the local newspaper and decided cross country wasn't that bad, so that was my first race experience.
Moral of the story is that we never leave.
Well, yeah, give yourself every opportunity.
All right, next. We're on to Jeff here. There's a picture of Jess with Jeff in his younger day.
Which one's
the
Jeff?
The blue one. How old were you then, Jeff?
Jesus.
Breaking your record there?
No, 19.
19?
Yeah.
So I didn't run properly until I left school. 18. I might have been 18, you're 12.
Okay.
And it'd have to be on the holidays, because I went to an all-boys school and we weren't allowed to like do anything to our hair, so every holidays, John Brockside and Tippett, and I'm wearing necklace, and my email used to be surfing153, a bit of background to that, but Craig Appleby, I now coach Craig Appleby, ran 65-35 half marathon recently.
Tim Norton, give you a plug.
Tim Norton, perennial injury man.
Pretty good runner, but they're all a lot older than you.
You're
a youngster. Did you have a normal sort of start to your running career, or?
No, not really. I guess I went through little athletics like everybody. And I got, in grade 6 I was all good. I was sort of the tallest in the class, and then I didn't grow until so. I sort of got fat and just pretty inactive, really. I still tried, but my younger brother, he was very good. He was better than I was. I tried to get him running, but he likes football better. We'd go down to cross country. My brother would win. Dad would be second, and I'd come third in our sort of local cross country. I always sort of kept competing, but it wasn't until I sort of grew. So year 11, I sort of started just running again at school. And then year 12 I ran again, and then that's when I joined Knox Athletics Club. Jumped 2 metres in high jump in year 12, so I used to just do a bit of everything really. I sort of had no real, I sort of didn't really grow up in like the, as like a talented kid as such, I guess, really didn't do it, but in the under 19 or under 17 Athletics Australia squads or anything, so I kind of just fell into running really.
So. You're playing it down a little bit there, but you did play in my basketball team once. I think you ended up as the highest scorer in the league, playing just one game.
On an average, yeah.
So you probably did have some talent.
Yeah,
being modest.
Right. Yeah, 18 40 points. I tried to slam dunk. Then I had to go call Disco the next day. I said, Chris, I can't walk. I was the hunchback in Notre Dame, my back had seized up. I'll never play.
We become pretty sport specific, I think.
Yeah, I'll never do any other sport other than running.
I tried to get him again, but it
wasn't worth the risk. For D grade, at no one.
Oh, yeah. Alright, next slide. What is going on here, Jess?
This was my 21st birthday. It was the night of Usain Bolt's final in the 2008 Beijing Olympics. So obviously the Olympic theme was suitable. Had this suit made up. That is actually, that night kind of marks. I remember I played a game of netball before my party that night, and that's the year I decided to stop playing netball and focus on running. So similarly to Jeff, I'd sort of gone through the little athletic system, and I came from Narracourt, so a country town in South Australia. We played netball, basketball, tennis. I loved all sports. Netball was my favourite, and I sort of dreamed of being one of the Adelaide Thunderbirds, the sort of the big team in Adelaide at the time. And that year turning 21 was when I just started to, I guess, make some improvements in running, having gone on a big around the world trip in second year uni at the age of 19. I thought, when I get back from this, if I don't miss running while I'm away, I'll just start focusing on netball. Came back, my coach retired, it seemed the right time to just stop and focus on netball, but in the meantime, Adam Diddick, this new enthusiastic injured runner, started coaching our group, and just pumped this new enthusiasm into running for me, and I started making some improvements, and that's when I went sort of, whoop, no, let's try the running path, and So that's, yeah, pretty...
Pretty good decision.
Yeah.
Just fell into it. I've got another competition coming up, so anyone who can tell us in the next photo, the second person in the photo is, wins some sort of headband. There we go. Shameless self-promotion from myself, a headband for you. All right, now, Jeff, this is obviously you at the front there training.
Kane on the crutches in third.
We're all here tonight. Training's obviously quite cruel as a distance runner. A lot of miles, very hard. Yeah. How do you stay motivated to run the amount that you do?
Good question. Running is pretty simple. It's like one foot in front of the other, and you do that competitively for a long time, you get fit and run well. But I guess what motivates me is just trying to see where my limits are. I guess I was lucky enough to be gifted with a bit of talent, so I get a bit of other rewards that sort of come along with it. But at the end of the day, I sort of just like trying to be better than I was the day before. While it's an individual sport, if I don't have training partners and a community around me, it's pretty difficult to run. So I've been lucky enough to sort of grow up out of the Knox Athletics Club and been, always with people, and always joke about how the running community is actually quite a unique one. Every Sunday I run out at Sophia Lake, and anyone can come and join me and run with me and chew my ear for 90 minutes. But if you want to try and get some time at Blue College, that's really quite nearly impossible. So the community is really pretty tight, and it's an individual sport, but I have a team of people, from coach, physio, doctor, masseur, training partners, and you really need all these people sort of working in unison to get good as well.
Good. The next slide. Jess, we've got your family here.
Yes, that's Mum in the orange in Glasgow.
Yeah, so they're all cheering on in Glasgow. There, at the bottom, there's some sort of stage photo.
I think that was when Jack got drafted.
How good a family picture is that?
Well, Abby's missing though. She was living in the country at the time. So.
And up on the right there is your brother, Jack. For those of you who don't know,
my little brother.
Jess's little brother plays for Melbourne, and I'm a Melbourne fan, so I'm a big Jack Pringo fan. I'm a big Jess fan as well. A little bit tall here. I don't know, Snowy, you're probably a little bit tall as well. Are you going to put your allegiance with Jess at the moment?
No comment.
Obviously, having such a successful younger brother as well, playing the AFL, captain of Melbourne, did that push you on a little bit?
Oh, definitely. Jack's my little brother, but I really look up to him and, tee up chats with him for advice all the time and sort of vice versa. He's just a really consistent level, kind of mature person who has some great sort of advice. And that year I talked about starting to focus on running. So my sister, Abby, who's 2 years younger than me, Jack's 4 years younger, she was rowing a lot through school and went off to the Youth Olympics, and just that experience looked incredible. She used to just have all these posters around her room with motivational quotes, and she was just so disciplined. She'd be up at 4:45 a.m. ride her bike down to West Lakes in Adelaide, which is sort of 45 minutes away, do a rowing session, and just seeing her schedule made me feel like, wow, I really, should have a crack at something myself. Jack was loving cricket in the summer and footy in the winter, and ended up sort of choosing football and was fortunate enough to get drafted. And just with those results, I just guess realised that, you can do it. If you work hard, you can, dream big. And I wanted to have a go at my goals too, so Abby and Jack were a huge inspiration.
And Jeff, obviously your family have been very supportive of your running as well. Really important as a runner. I've looked up on Google, there's
such a thing called the selfish runner syndrome. And it talks about how runners want to go out and run, and they won't stop themselves from running for anything. So you have to have people around you that are going to be supportive, or else it's going to be difficult.
So what was it? You go for a run late?
Well, you put running ahead of everything else.
Yeah, that's what you got.
Which I think probably a few people relate to.
But
your family.
I'm talking about family.
And I think you need supportive people around.
Yeah, I need support. I got into sport really late, so like I said, that photo was 18. The following year, I played AFL football for Mazenhall Collegians because I wasn't really running much, or I didn't really see a path anywhere, or no one really showed me the path. And so, 2006 Commonwealth Games come around, and Craig Mottram, obviously, I was at a stadium there, and I was like, all right, I need to probably do this a little bit harder. And that's when I sort of started running. And at that stage, I sort of finished school in 04, and this was 06, and I'd sort of been trying to get into uni, because I worked hard at uni, but I'm not a real switched on, kind of naturally smart guy. So I sort of had to work my back way into uni. And sort of 2006, 2007, I was working a little bit, but my old man has a vegetable sort of wholesaling company, and he goes to work 11 p.m. at night and gets home at 3 p.m. the next afternoon, so he's working 75 hours a week, night shift, and I'm thinking, so I guess I learned a bit of work ethic through my old man, and you know, he was helping me continue to run, because you obviously don't make money out of running until you get to a pretty high level, and then even still it's pretty difficult. So yeah, without family, I'd be stuffed really.
I think the other thing with parents, probably the same with yours, but mine certainly, they made sure we had the opportunity to take on every opportunity, make the most of every opportunity, I guess. They, if we made a team, mum and dad were excited and supported us to try and get there, because in the junior years, it often does require, self-funding and, whole fundraisers in Narracourt or whatever. The community would sort of get around it for athletes who made teams, and I think the other thing is they just wanted us to be happy, and never really told me to go out and run or train for this event, just as long as we were happy, mum and dad were happy, and I think that was a really nice thing, because it meant that we were making our own choices and never felt like we were trying to do something to meet mum and dad's expectations. And like, as a parent one day, hopefully that's how I'd love to be, just be there for that support, but not sort of putting expectations on your kids.
All right, let's go with another competition here. We've got a few more prizes to give away. If anyone can tell me, and I did put it up on the screen before, what Jess's PB for the marathon is, they'll win a bag, an ASICS bag. Anyone else? Yeah. At the back.
I think two times you hear this.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
It was 2:30 something. 2:30 something.
That's close enough. That is close. I think that's the best prize of the night as well.
12 seconds is a hard time.
Oh, yeah. 2:30 and 12, which is an unbelievable run. Next slide.
That's not what you've
been doing. All right, Jeff, first of all, I want to ask you how you mentally prepare for competitions. Obviously, racing is very stressful, and you get a little bit worked up. Is there any strategies that you have to prepare yourself on race day? And it's the same with everyone in running. We all get nervous.
This was actually something I had to work really hard on post 2012, because I used to get really nervous before races, and I used to ask my coach, just keep asking questions, what do I do here, what do I do here, what do I do here. I never felt like I was in control of anything. For whatever reason, we never really addressed the issue, like in terms of, mental coaching or or anything like that. It was just run a shitload and then you'll be all right. That was pretty much my previous coaches' advice. So, I sort of started working with Paulette Misford out of the BIS, and I guess being an exercise science student and sports management, I'm sort of a bit of a, like constantly learning about myself and running, and a real sort of student of running. So I'm not really a sports side kind of guy who likes to really sit there and divulge in his feelings and whatever else, but I got a lot out of just sort of understanding how the body works in terms of arousal levels, you know, being too aroused and then not being aroused enough and sort of being anxious and all that sort of stuff, and just sort of, I guess, the effect that has on hormone and that sort of helped me a lot. And then, you know, from there we sort of work backwards and try to work out a plan of, all right, well, I get to the track an hour and a half before the race, you know, what do I do? You know, I start warming up now before the race, you know, just sort of going through little strategies and trying to make things like autopilot so it just becomes normal. And, you know, I have a little routine in the core room where I take in a hacky sack and I sort of throw it to myself at the rhythm of what I feel like I'm about to go out and run. So I guess, yeah, just trying to be really in tune with everything that I'm sort of doing. And before a race, I sort of just try and lower my heart rate and sort of close my eyes and just relax and just sort of get ready for it. Because once the gun goes off, it's instinct and you go and you work it out, you know. And I guess sort of backtracking even further is, you know, 2 or 3 days out, I'll start visualising the race and, you know, where I need to be and what I need to do. And I guess the challenge with middle distance running that perhaps Jess doesn't have is our event goes from between 1:45 and 3.5 minutes, so you've got to be able to react, and you can't control the race, you never really know what's going to happen. So you've sort of got to have a template. And, you know, now I'm 28, I've had a lot of races, and now I sort of just back myself. And not sure if anyone watched Beijing, but I was actually last with 200 to go, and I sort of spoke to my old man afterwards, and he said, "Jesus, you scared the shit out of me." And I was like, "What are you talking about?" I said, "I went past 3 bars with 100 to go, and, you know, 70 to go, I was picking up the third guy." And then I watched the replay back, and I didn't actually do anything until about 60 to go, and I got the last guy with 30 to go. But I guess, you know, that, you know, I've sort of, you know, getting older and just more mature, I didn't panic, and I knew what I had, and I got there. So just trying to be as prepared as you can without sort of going, turning into a crazy person, I guess. And, now I'm really fortunate. You know, I had a really positive experience in Glasgow this year. I won the double nationals at the national park, the 800 and 1500 meter title at the nationals. And, you know, Beijing would have been great except for a rupture of a plantar in the hip. So I'm starting to sort of build these positive experiences of, you know, races where I've done well, and, you know, I was just trying to think back to what it felt like then and replicate it. That's pretty much how I'm trying to work out.
So, recently at the World Champs, you had an eruption later.
Yep.
Injury, devastating. Semi-final, you know, you're like ready to go, great shape.
Yeah, yeah.
How does that feel, and how do you cope with it?
I guess, now being a few weeks post and sort of speaking to a little bit of the AA, they sort of really, they were very impressed with how I handled myself. And I guess it's like when you're going into a major champs and you haven't really run for 3 or 4 days and you've got cortisone in your foot and you're not really sure where you're at, you can go pretty crazy. But I guess a lot of the sort of stuff that I did with Paulette and a lot of the sports psych, you know, I can control the things I can control and I plan for the things I can't control. And, you know, none of this I can control, but I just had to trust in my medical people. And I'd actually tore my left plantar in a race in 2010, and now I was having trouble with the right, so I'd sort of been in that situation before. And I turned up to the heat, and I wasn't going well, but we injected with local, and there's an ultrasound machine there, which was not great before you're about to go up and run it. A heat of a world championship, you're sitting on a table with an ultrasound machine with the doc getting ready to stick a needle in you. And it gives me, I have a lot more respect for the footy boys and what they put their body through, and it's actually quite mental. But I've talked a lot, I don't know where I'm going with this. Oh, disappointment. So as much as disappointing as Glasgow Beijing was, I sort of took a lot of confidence from the way that I handled myself in the heat and the 3 or 4 days leading into it. And like, I knew I was in the shape that I wanted to be. And you know, I'm disappointed I didn't get a chance to race against Amos and Rudisha and test myself against the best guys in the world, because that's the next step that I want to take. But you move on to the next thing. You know, I got Rio in a year, so you can't sort of put yourself, you know, you can't be, you know, too down for too long. You've got to get up and put a goal down. You know, I arrived back in Melbourne on sort of, I raced on the Saturday, tried to race. I injected it again on the Sunday to try and get up for the semi, but functionality wise, I couldn't actually get the power out of my foot, so I was no chance to go again. And got a flight home Tuesday, arrived Wednesday, Thursday I had an MRI, Friday I had surgery. So, you know, 4 weeks Friday, start running on the Ultra G, and it literally just starts again. And I guess that's the crazy, that's how crazy we are. We're just always.
Obviously, with injuries, it's difficult to take.
Yeah.
Jess, you've had injuries as well, leading up to the Commonwealth Games, and this is probably...
Who hasn't had an injury?
Yeah.
This is probably a different story
with injury, I think. But Jess, you had an injury before the Commonwealth Games where you actually got a bronze medal and you ran a PB. So, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, you certainly learn a lot from an injury. You learn a lot about your body and yourself. And it was a really challenging time. So the Glasgow Commonwealth Games Marathon was on the July the 27th. And Easter, so in April, I was out on a run and just felt this twinge in my foot. And so as a physio, sometimes I think it works against me, because as I'm sort of pushing through it, I'm trying to diagnose what it might be. Instead of just being scared and stopping, I sort of thought, oh, I'll just see if it warms up, and it didn't warm up. And I went off that weekend to Easter and thought, I'll just walk and rest for a few days. It just wasn't getting better, and it was diagnosed as a second metatarsal, so a bone in your foot, stress injury. And so I took 4 weeks off at that point, and my mum and dad were actually, so I was sort of between houses and had moved into mum and dad's place at the time, and they'd gone overseas on this holiday before the Commonwealth Games. So I was home alone at the time, and just basically my sister's ergo was in the shed. So every morning I'd get on the ergo for 40 minutes watching the Today Show or something, and running for 40 minutes is a lot easier than being on a rowing machine.
That's cross track.
Yeah, I was at my coach's house on the spin bike, and he saw me in tears a number of times and just kept on saying, you know, just focus on the goal. But I did start to doubt that I'd actually be ready to run a marathon in time, and just having my coach there believing in me, and my family and friends saying, you'll be all right, and, you know, my parents saying, if you don't run over here, we're going to have a great holiday anyway, don't worry about us. It was about 8 to 10 weeks before the marathon I got to start running training again. So I'd been keeping fit with elliptical boxing. Boxing was really good at getting my heart rate up, because I found the bike, without using your arms, I couldn't pedal fast enough to get my heart rate as high as I wanted it.
Would your legs blow up before your heart rate?
Yeah, so I'd try and like be on the bike, pumping my arms as well, but...
I'm not sure, Jess, everyone has that problem, but...
Yeah. It is harder on the bike to get your heart rate up, but boxing, it does it really well. So that, I didn't use my feet much to begin with, it was also the arms. As my foot became better, I started to get my legs involved a bit more. So it was a really challenging time, but honestly, when I got to the time where I was allowed to start running, I was so motivated. I had this new perspective and appreciation for running. For a while there, I thought I might have to switch to rowing, because I thought maybe my foot's just gone, because obviously an MRI shows up everything in your foot and shows some other areas of degeneration and whatnot, which is probably natural for a runner who runs a lot, but it scared me a bit.
So you were thinking you were going to become a rower?
Well, I remember crying on Saturday afternoon thinking, if I can't run, you know, in the future, like, I need something. And so that put my mind at ease, thinking there's other sports out there.
Yeah,
it's
got the perfect
build
for
rowing. Long limbs.
The big muscles.
So I got to the start line. I actually felt a little bit fresher than I usually would for a marathon, I think, because of the short, sharp prep.
So are you encouraging people not to train for a marathon?
Well, I think
the running is obviously very important, and I'd run 4 marathons prior to that. So you've got to give credit to all of the training and conditioning prior to. It just goes to show, though, if you can work on your aerobic fitness, and then obviously there's 8 to 10 weeks of running training beforehand were really important, but it just shows how mental marathon running is, because I just went into that race so excited to be running and actually loved it, and feeling happy and positive, I think, just keeps you in, you know, good form. I felt stronger in the later stages of the race, I think, from some of the boxing and the strength I'd gained in that, and it was a really positive injury in the end. I've been a lot better off this year for having gone through that.
And I think the fact that you only started running about 8 to 10 weeks out from the marathon shows that you can, you know, relate to this. That as a physio, we get people coming to us and they, you know, they might be 8 to 10 weeks out from a marathon and they've got an injury. It's not definitely the end of the world. That work you've done before is really important, and I think it sees you through. To winning a bronze medal at the Commonwealth Games.
And really trusting the team around you. Like, I had to just trust that my physio and doctor, you know, were giving me sound advice, and the doctor had sort of said, well, there's a chance you could, you know, fracture the bone in the race because of the weakened areas there. But he said, if this happens, the specific area in the bone where it is, like, it will heal in 6 weeks, and just... Yeah, that was a scary thing to hear, but yeah, you do need to maybe get a few opinions and then just go with your gut and trust them.
Alright, Jeff, one more question from me and then I'm going to open it up to the audience. Are there any injury prevention things that you do in terms of the gym? I know we've got Jess here sitting beside you, who's a clinical Pilates instructor. I know you probably do a little bit of Pilates as well. Leading you into it a little bit, but are there any other things that you do as well? And what would you think would be most important?
Injury prevention strategy, for me personally, having a lot of injuries is probably low management. I run a lot less than what I used to. I used to sort of run up to 160k, now I'm probably still 110, maybe 120. And we use a program called TrainFix that logs heart rate, and I log a heart rate GPS for every single run, and at the end of the season just spits out some pretty cool data in terms of average kilometers per week and all this sort of thing. So, and it's sort of, this program over 40 days, it logs chronic training load and it gives you a value, and then over 7 days it gives you acute training load and logs that, and it sort of spits out all these graphs that my coach knows a lot about this, he's really switching on to all this, but it basically gives you probably the closest thing that you can get, rather than saying you're ready to race, actually gives you a bit of a scientific sort of thing. So we use that a lot. For me, like building a team, so, you know, having like a physio, you know, doc and my coach, I'm unofficially the 47th football player at the football club. I've been using their facilities since 2008. My coach is the high performance manager. My physio is the head physio there. My doctor's the head doc there. My masseur is the masseur there. So it's kind of nice that they're all working together and they have a relationship. So, you know, if I have a problem, I go see the physio, and then next minute I'm going to look past the doc and I'll have a scan, and, you know, in 6 hours we know what we're doing, and then we get on with it, and it's like 2 weeks, all right, this is the diagnosis. Know, rather than sort of let things linger. So I think another thing is really being in tune with your body and sort of being able to read the signs, and obviously being able to communicate that to your coach and physio and all that sort of thing. But at the moment, like, I can't run, so I'm literally smashing Pilates on the reformer 3 times a week and trying to get a bit of a ghetto booty at the moment. Just trying to sort of really load up my glutes and the hamstring adductors, sort of all those sort of stabilizing things around my hip, you know, that sort of, you know, I guess, take a lot of that load and distribute that load down sort of the chain to your ankles and whatever. So, you know, I can't do this sort of stuff while I'm running because, you know, I'm just running too much and get too tired. So, yeah, there's sort of little strategies, but, you know, foam rollers, I get massage Monday, Friday, I have physio Wednesday, so, you know, my life is routine and it's clockwork and I'm a bit of a perfectionist, so I like to sort of control everything. If I can sort of keep on top of everything, then, you know, that helps with my intervention. So,
I think I was speaking to Jess the other day, she came to the clinic and she said, I saw Jeff in his speedos the other day.
Yeah.
Do a little bit of swimming as well?
Yeah, do a little bit of swimming. So, I hate swimming. Well, I don't hate it, but I prefer to be running. So, I go into the pool and I try and get as much bang for the buck as I can. So, one of the things I like to do is, like, I swim 25, like I try and swim without breathing, so it's just like, I know that sounds funny, but you like get it. So like I'll swim 25 meters without breathing and I'll have short recovery and then I'll swim sort of 50 meters, so after that 20 minutes, like it's basically hypoxic stuff, so you get up and then do a bit of short recovery and then you get back in and you swim really hard. And today I did just flat out 50s just trying to get lactic. And I'm just trying to replicate running, but the reason I'm pretty much doing cross training is so that I can continue to eat a little bit of chocolate and ice cream and have a few frothies and not put on too much weight.
Probably half the reason why I run it,
Bloody sugar cravings. We all go, no worries.
All right, I've asked enough questions. Anyone got any questions in the crowd?
No.
Oh, we've got one in the front row here. What's your name? I might give you the microphone. Right close up to the microphone and ask you a question, but you're going to put it right in your mouth.
What are your 800 tactics?
Is this to Jeff?
Jeff.
Probably. Is this to Jeff?
Don't ask for my 800 tactics.
Yeah, that's a good question.
Maybe
like
even splitting.
Yeah, I guess pace strategy is probably the simplest way is the most important thing. So I guess for yourself, at your age, there's a lot of variabilities because people are at all different stages and whatever. When I'm sort of competing, everyone's within half a second, so it becomes a bit more important. But pace strategy, so trying to make the first lap the second lap as close to the pace of your first lap. So if you might run 250 for 800, I'm just guessing, you know, your first lap might be 125 and hopefully your next lap is 125. If you go out in 110 and you run 140 for your last one, then that's a really good way to do it. I guess your body goes into a state of lactic where you actually can't physically keep moving it. So if you can prevent that from happening by getting a good pace strategy, then that's sort of the optimal way to run, because before Beijing, I watched I went through all the London heats, all the debut heats, the 2011 World Champs, all the Moscow 2003 Champs, and I watched every single race and what time they went through the first lap, what time they went through 600, what they ran for the last 100, and I basically worked out that they usually go through between 52 and 53, first lap, last lap, 119, 120, and if you can close in 26 flat, then you can be automatically qualified. So I know that probably doesn't relate to you, but yeah.
That's been 200 meters, 26 seconds.
26 seconds for the last 200. But pace strategy and but at your age, I think it doesn't really matter. I think you just go out and you just, like, kids are on this improvement curve where, you know, you just gotta put yourself outside your comfort zone and just get used to running hard. So with that, a bit of pace strategy too. Yeah.
In terms of marathon, have you got any advice on pacing a marathon?
How many people here run marathons? How many people would say they've sort of even splitted the first half similar to the second? Yeah, so that's sort of the way I really like to run a marathon, to aim to even split, and that's what my coach said before Glasgow. He said, I'd really like you to get to 21 kilometres in this race feeling like you're ready to take on the second half. That's when the race starts. So deliver your body to halfway in a state ready to race. And I know Michael Shelley, who won the gold medal at Glasgow, he actually, it was really, my coach Adam Dinnick was the marathon team coach in Glasgow, and he is a perfectionist and likes to do all the research and deliver as much information as possible. And he went to do that to the entire marathon team before the race, and sort of had this little flyby and all the corners, and Michael Shelley started to walk out of the room, and Adam's like, oh, Mike, I'm just going through it, and he's like, I don't want to, he's like, it's two laps, right? And Adam's like, yeah, and he goes, first lap's for sightseeing, the second lap, nowhere to go. So he just doesn't want to bar, but Michael, he's like, that first lap will be my enjoying getting to know the course, and then the second lap. All right, so it's quite interesting, people's different approaches. I like to sort of visualise it, so I like to know where I'll be and actually see the course. But in terms of pacing, I think a really enjoyable way to run it is to try and, I guess, really know your form going into the race, so you've got a good idea of, you know, what time you want to run and should be able to run. Half that, and that's about what you want to go through halfway in. That's my approach.
Have you got any formulas that you use in terms of 10K time or half marathon?
I guess what I would do is look at, you know, my best marathon and the last 10K race I ran in the lead up to that. Or, you know, in this case, City Bay Fun Run was on the weekend. You know, that's something I can compare and look at my time in relation to the time I ran before my best marathon. If I'm faster, well, that tells me, you know, hopefully I'm in shape to run a faster marathon. So I don't use a specific formula like Chris Wardlaw and some of the marathon greats do. They've got all these fancy ways of working times out. But I just, as I said, the power of the mind, it's crazy. So if you limit yourself by what, if, you know, the mathematical equation says, you can run.
Is there a rough thing from, like, a lot of people obviously run half before they run a marathon. Can you get a good idea from a half?
I think you add 6 minutes. Double your half marathon time, add 6. But again, I don't think...
It's probably a bit different, yeah.
All right, any other questions from the room? Up the back, yellow shirt.
Just one for Jess. We, as long distance runners, we tend to get injured more on our, say, tempo runs and interval sessions than we do actually on our long runs. Do you think, what sort of pace should an interval run all that be at? I mean, I think maybe sometimes we actually go at race pace more than we should, is that right?
Yeah, well, look, having come from South Australia, this year I've been based in Melbourne and I've had the chance to, you know, work alongside some guys like Craig Mottram and Chris Wardlaw, and my coach is working closely with them too. Craig sort of put it in a nice way the other week and said, you know, it's a long road race that you're preparing for, so you need to have some long road runs in there. But, so they're really important in your training program, but then the sessions should just complement them nicely by being, you know, 6 to 8 Ks in total in volume, maybe up to 10, but faster than race pace. So you're getting your legs used to and your body used to a pace that's faster than your race pace to make that race pace feel more comfortable. But you're not letting them take away from your longer running. So it's where if, you know, 6 Ks is manageable for you at that faster than race pace time, and that might be broken into, you know, a 3K followed by 3 1K reps or something like that. I also think the tempo runs are really important and they're kind of playing around that race pace. And then you've got your long runs, which are generally slower than race pace. But one thing I love and that makes me feel really prepared for marathon is bringing home the long run in a strong pace. So actually the final half hour of my long runs, when I'm starting to get into the real heart of the marathon prep, I like to get faster as I go in that final half hour to show yourself that you're strong enough to actually, you know, come home strong.
That'd be race pace?
Not quite race pace. So if race pace is, say, 3:33, they would get to like maybe 3:36 in the final few Ks. The other week I actually chucked my race flats on for the final 40 minutes of my 2.5 hour run and just got the legs going to...
Just on the run to push it off.
I know, it was risky. I thought if I bend down I might never get up again. But you're right, it can be that unfamiliar running that causes your injury. So I guess it's what your goal is in the marathon. If it's to finish a marathon, you can probably get away without doing the intensity work and just doing long runs. But if you've got a time target, I think those fartlek interval sessions a bit quicker than race pace are really important.
And Jeff, in terms of being an 800 metre run predominantly, Jeff is a marathon, the difference there, 42k compared to 800 metres.
Yeah.
You would think that the training for that is going to be particularly different. I'm probably trying to ask for people in the crowd who are geared towards shorter stuff.
Yeah.
Do you still do very, very long distances, or do you...
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's not too much different, really, for 80% of the year. There's a sort of a 20% of the year when we're in Europe and we're sharpening up, but, you know, from when I can start running again, or if I was healthy right now and I was in my sort of Rio prep from October to end of January and probably May to... or mid-April to mid-June, I'm probably doing 6 to 8 Ks of interval training on the track and probably doing, you know, 25-30 minute threshold, so 7.5 to sort of 9K. Long run on a Sunday, still 90 minutes. And I'm like Jess, I like to really, sometimes we really hammer home that last 15 minutes. You know, we might start out at 5 minute Ks, but by the end we might be running, yeah, 3:30s for, you know, the last 10. So, yeah, it's not too really dissimilar. I guess the biggest thing is the skeleton of it's the same. It's just that we don't do as much of the, you know, the running around it. So the afternoon runs, the doubles, the sort of the longer Wednesday mornings, a lot of that sort of stuff. But, you know, I still head out to Bliss Paddocks and do 8-5K over the hills and sort of that sort of stuff. So, you know, 800, 1500 running, while it's, you know, you've got to be quite fast. You can be as fast as you want, but if you don't have the aerobic capacity to keep up, then you're stuffed anyway. So it really is, you know, a fine sort of balance between getting that aerobic stuff and getting that anaerobic at home.
So I guess a few guys out in the crowd who are training for marathons, if they step onto the track and ramp up, they might do okay.
Yeah, well, it's like Jess, it's the same concept. She talked about running faster than race pace to get, you know, so if your race pace is 3:30, running 3:15s, if you've done that, going back to running 3:30s is the same. You know, we might run 300s in, you know, 35, 36 seconds, which is sort of 47, 48 seconds for 100 pace. So again, that's ready to go through in 51, it just makes it a little bit easier. So it's really the same principle, it's just on a different scale, really. Yeah.
Question?
So both of you, like obviously you had good sporting talents when you were younger and you've done quite a lot of different sports and you haven't really specifically knowledge of running until you were older. But as a parent of someone who's doing quite well with their running, but she does a few different sports,
there's
a lot of pressure to put a child into one sport.
Yeah.
And I'm actually on the physio as well, so I'm pretty much against that, but you've got it coming in all different angles that you I don't know who else has got kids here that, you know, are doing well at the sport, but you have the coaches in the room, they're saying, you've got to come to this, you've got to come to this, and then, you know, someone gets a scholarship here, and you just feel like, should I be doing this? Am I not doing the right thing for her?
Yeah.
So I'm just sort of, what's your opinion on that? I'll just shut it all out and...
I think trying to do everything. I did gymnastics at your age. I was in cartwheels and splits and hanging off the bars and... I grew up playing basketball, playing football, and I guess from an exercise science point of view and a physio point of view, I think doing all that stuff for motor learning and like
this. It always seems like now, the times of now, it's people, like I know one of my friends has gone to private schools and sports scholarship, they run 5 times a week.
Yeah.
You know, just for a 12-year-old version of something, more, it's just so much.
Yeah, and there's probably a lot of cases out there by the time it's 18, you're not actually in the sport anymore. So it's I think it's about progression, and it's number one, it's got to be for fun. Because as soon as the fun goes away, no matter how much they train, they're not going to be any good. So, yeah, I think it's encouraging them to get into the participate, but
I think for females, if you are hoping to compete from your 20s onwards, those teenage years are so crucial. It's where you're really building and developing your bone density. And obviously, as females, you need to go through those natural processes and be developing the, producing the right hormones and whatnot. If you interrupt that natural process and you're not producing enough estrogen, you can get to 21 with a lower than normal bone density and end up with issues with bone stress injuries. So all I'd suggest to young girls, and I know my coach has had to learn a lot about this because he coaches a lot of young female athletes, is it's just so important to get that energy balance right and go through the normal developmental process. And if training started to interfere with that, I think education's a lot better now, but that's where it's worth going to a doctor and a nutritionist and just making sure that you're getting in enough energy, because I think it's easier to burn more than you're actually getting in at that age. So in terms of sports specificity, I see there'd be challenges when you're being offered Australian teams and things like that as a junior. You want to make the most of those opportunities, but you just don't want to burn out mentally either. So just keep reflecting and making sure that you're enjoying what you're doing. And if you ever start to feel you're losing that enjoyment, maybe do go into some of those other sports for a while, and you can always come back to running.
I think environment is the key. So I'm from the Knox Athletics Club, and I sort of went through Richard Huggins, and he's sort of all fun approach. And the kids turn up on Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, and they do some really basic aerobic work, but it's more like they enjoy turning up to train with each other. And I think if you just sort of, if you kind of just keep that in that fun environment, then pretty safe. But you've got to be really careful. Part of me thinks that, because I actually didn't start running until I was 18, 19, that so I got a stress fracture in my fibula at 21, because I've gone from nothing to heaps. So, I've just worked with Zach Patterson, who got fifth at World Juniors last year, and I've sort of been working with him since 16, and, just encouraging him and setting little goals and little things just to, keep getting better and better. And it's just progression, that is the key. And just making sure it's not too quick.
Okay. Next question. Lynn's a water bottle, and we've got it at the back there.
Nick?
Yeah?
How do you guys deal with those times when training doesn't, just isn't fun? Sometimes that can only be a couple of days, but sometimes it then can turn into a couple of weeks. How do you pull yourself out of those times when things don't feel like they're going great?
That environment thing's really important there. I love people, and making it social is the key for me. So organising to meet people for runs, making sure you've got a group that you can meet for your key sessions, changing up your running route can help, but also goal setting. So you might have a big long-term goal in a year's time, but having smaller goals along the way that you can work towards, so you've got that little high of a race and then a bit of recovery after to break up the cycle.
Sometimes you get 12 weeks into a training block where it just feels like you're beating your head against a wall, and it's like your body's just like, we all go through it, but goal setting is another one. I was really on the edge in Europe, but when I had Beijing coming, I was trained like a maniac, but I had Beijing always in the corner, and I was like, all right, just got to keep going week after week. But I think if it goes on for too long, it's probably a sign that maybe actually need to take a week off and go for a weekend down a lawn, or just get away from it a bit.
Make yourself miss it.
Yeah, just freshen up. And Jess is obviously getting ready for Melbourne. I'm sort of on a break, and on a break I actually enjoy getting completely away from it and just doing things I don't normally get to do. And I think as an athlete too, we get so caught up in the goal setting, and it's like, I could be in Europe and I've won a race, and it's like, all right, shit, 90-minute run tomorrow and you don't actually stand back to kind of enjoy the journey. And, you know, that's, you know, up until the London Olympics, I just sort of wasn't really enjoying it. And now, like, I'm just grateful for all the opportunities I get and, you know, like, you know, the feeling of running PB, you know. Sometimes it doesn't happen very often for, you know, when we get to our level, we're sort of really that pointy end and we're competing against all these athletes who are crazy. You know, so when you do get that moment, you've really got to enjoy it and hold on to it for a bit. And yeah, so.
Next. Yep.
With risk mitigation or injury mitigation, how much of your training, Jeff, is done in spines?
Yeah, not a lot really. I'll only get in spikes sort of when I feel like I actually need them. You know, and that's probably, you know, when I'm running under 55 seconds or 58 seconds for a 400 or. But the other thing is, you can't just not be in spikes and then all of a sudden go in spikes, because as soon as you go in them, people probably know you, like, your cast well up and they're tight. Yeah, so I think it's just sometimes, like, if you're going to a track session and you know, your session might have been 5k of intervals and the last thing you finish up is some 300s, it's always good just to chuck them on and, well, A, it makes you feel a lot faster and if, you know, it makes you feel good. So it's sort of like weaning into them. But yeah, I guess with the amount of k's we run, we've got to make sure we're always in really good footwear, and I guess we're both lucky enough to get our shoes for free so we can swap them over regularly. But from an injury point of view, yeah, like, I always try to have something pretty supportive, but at the same time, you still got to throw different challenges in your body because it does adapt and it gets better. So, yeah. When was the last time you spoke?
Yeah, so I've run Zatopek Classic here in Melbourne for the last 7-8 years, and I wear spikes often for that race. So I'll do probably 3 or 4 sessions.
So how long is that race?
10 kilometres. Sorry.
Oh, 10 spikes.
Yeah. So I'll do a few sessions in spikes prior to that, or you might have been walking for a few days, because spikes do encourage you to get up on your toes more and means you're going to be stressing your calf.
Question. A couple more questions.
He's got 2 questions.
You would win in a 10-kilometer race between the
both of you. Who would win in a 10-kilometer race between both of you? I'd say Jeff would have a faster PB than me over 10 kilometres. Maybe right now, because he's on his break.
Where would our key matchup be, like, in distance? Because I would be able to run 2:30 for marathon.
20 kilometres?
Walking around 70.
Wait, marathon is 71.
You'll back yourself in that, aren't you? You will. I think you'll back yourself in a marathon.
Maybe 30k's?
I'm a guy,
Jeff,
so I'm lucky to have
Jeff,
more muscle mass.
He comes from a high book. Like, Jeff's a very fit 800 metre runner. Some 800 metre runners get
you
away without. I'd like to think I could get Dylan. Some come from 400 metres and step up to the 800, whereas Jeff's long runs are amazing. So I think 30 kilometres we'll go with. But we won't do it tonight. What was your other question?
You want to have the microphone for this one? Right on your mouth. You've got to put it right up your mouth.
What do you eat for breakfast to get you really fast?
Breakfast before a race or just general breakfast? I'm a music guy. It gets boring after a while.
I grew up on porridge. My dad used to make porridge every morning. So it was oats and yogurt and seeds and whatnot soaked overnight. But these days I like to make this banana pancake. It's banana, egg, bit of my protein powder, cinnamon, chia seeds, mix it all up and it makes a really yummy pancake with yogurt, and it's got the right balance of protein and carbs for recovery, because I often do a run and then have breakfast. So that's my standard these days.
Women are way more in tune with this stuff.
Does that include ice cream with those pancakes?
What was that, sorry?
He just wants to know if you can include ice cream with those pancakes.
Well, you could, that would taste good. Blueberries are good too. I think I started working with a dietitian after the London Olympics because with marathon running, the carbohydrate loading and whatnot is quite specific, but what I really learned is the importance of that meal within half an hour of each sessions.
That's okay. What have you been told you need to have, like in grams of protein?
I ate for 22 grams of protein and then about your body's weight worth in carbs.
Yeah, same, like 75 carbs and 20 grams of protein. So that's the general, I guess, sort of very basic rule of thumb. Within half an hour.
Sorry, when I say body weight, I don't mean 50-something kilograms of grams.
You're holding it down pretty well.
If anyone's away for dinner tonight, Getting a meal with protein and carbohydrates to kickstart that muscle and tissue healing phase. It's good for injury prevention, but also recovery to get you right for the next run.
It's a big M count. That's 19 grams.
Big M.
A runner's always like a big M.
Yeah.
We get told by a dietitian that if you can't get anything, chocolate milk
chocolate
is
milk is good, apparently. So, I think the best protein to try and get in is the whey protein. I think if it's a big M versus nothing, very
good
for a big M.
Have you got any sponsors there,
Jesse? Oh, the protein powders, you just need to be careful with the SADA and the drug testing and whatnot these days. You just need to go with the ones that the sports dietitians recommend, and Masashi products and Body Science are pretty well. They're not sponsors, that's just the information I'm
giving. Anyone else have a question?
Yeah. I got a question for each of you. I'll start with Chair. Just in terms of preference, with championships you have to go through heats, semis and finals, and if you go Diamond League or Tour meets, you just go straight final.
Yeah.
What's your preference? What do you prefer to do?
Because it's a different sort of thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it requires a bit of different training. I guess coming from that, like Jess said, I come from a really aerobic kind of background in terms of how I reach the eight. So three rounds obviously suits me. I kind of feel like I get better as I go along. But I used to be really scared of major champs. And I used to be really good at just the diving leagues, getting on the train and just go. Now I kind of really look forward to it and I thrive just literally standing next to a guy thinking how I'm going to beat this guy. So, no preference. I like both of them because in one part, I like running PBs, and in a major championship you don't really get a chance because it's usually slow and tactical. And so I like to just change it up and run PBs, and then obviously, figure out ways. This year Rhodesia had to change his ways. London he ran 1:40, which was just like ridiculous, damn incredible. But this year everyone been sitting on him and he wasn't in 1:40 shape, and Amos and other guys were beating him in the last 100, so he had to sort of change his ways, and everyone's still scared of him and everyone still thinks he's just going to lead that race out and in 50 points, and they'll sit there, and this time he went 53 and he made it even slower to 600, and no one was really too scared to go past him. Then all of a sudden he runs 24.5 for his last 200, and if he's running 24.5 and he's a metre or two in front of you, he's got the curve and you're 2-3 wide, you've got to start running 23.5, which is nearly impossible. So respect to Rhodesia for reinventing himself this year.
And I guess with that, this year at the Australian Championships you ran the 800 and 1500.
Yep.
And you won both.
Yep.
How many rounds were there? And
Four races in 4 days.
Yeah.
So
you've got to prepare for that.
Yeah, prepare for it, and
Yeah, I don't know, I like it. I was really nervous because I was coming up against two current Australian record holders, and you know, the problem with doing both is you risk losing both. Whereas if you do one, you could just win one. But I kind of like the challenge, and you know, you finish the race and you go through the coverage strategies, you eat and you get up and you do it again, and it's just like clockwork for 4 days. And when it's all finished, you have a few beers and have a good time and reflect on the year. That was pretty cool.
And Jesse, probably more of a one race. Like these days. You're not going to be able to do more than one marathon in a short period of time.
No, I don't really have any events. Like I love racing the old 5K on track, but I don't do that at the level where you have rounds. So at nationals, it's just one 5K.
I have a question for you. That's on probably with this topic. How many marathons do you run a year, and how, if you do more than one, is there a certain amount of time that you need to have between them, and how much recovery post-marathon,
yeah,
that sort of stuff might be interesting.
Well, I've only ever done two in a year. That's been my maximum. I think three would be like possible. So it really depends how you run it. Completing the marathon distance, it's okay to run, you know, multiple in a year, but if you're really, you know, doing the full preparation, taper, having a real crack, I think more than three would be, you'd just sort of run out of time, because I take about 6 weeks before I get into, you know, really good training again. That first week, sometimes I'm struggling to run after a marathon. That first week can be hurting to walk, let alone run. Second week might get back into some light jogging. At 4 weeks, with the 5 marathons I've done so far, I'm still lacking a bit of coordination. I often feel okay, but my coach says you just don't look right. You know, your legs aren't. So I've sort of started to get back into some tempo runs by that point, but really hard, high volume sessions I wouldn't do, you know, any sooner than probably 6 weeks. So work out how many weeks in a year, yeah, you would be wanting to do more than 3 marathons. Each marathon I do, though, I tend to pull up a bit better, so I think as I'm getting stronger, I'm recovering better on the other side of it.
I'm going to do another competition here. Who has done the most marathons in 1 year, and they will win a visor?
Yeah. I've done 12 in 1 year.
Can anyone top that? That's hard to beat. Can anyone top it?
In 2012, in 11 different countries.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Two prizes. So 12 marathons in a year.
By the next weekend would probably be starting to get back into, yeah, so after the Gold Coast, for example, I had a jog week of like 40 to 60 minutes each day, just depending on how I was feeling, and by that weekend I think I was back into a session. But back in my first few half marathons, I took a long time to recover, so again, I think just as I'm running more and my body's becoming more conditioned, I'm starting to feel better. Like, I had City Bay yesterday and I was able to run quite comfortably today, but a few years ago after City Bay, I would have been, you know, really sore, so.
Two more questions from the crowd.
That lady just there.
Jessie, you're preparing for Melbourne Marathon. What's your aim for your time?
I really like to, yeah, get a performance that would likely qualify me for Rio. Now, it's a difficult one because the official time we've got to get is 2 hours 42, but they can only take 3 females and females in the marathon or in any event. And so you've got to look at the other Aussie girls that are, you know, trying to qualify, and we have got quite a few girls having a crack. So I'd like to run under 2 hours 30, and I think that would give me confidence that I'm, you know, in,
up there.
Yeah, but I've got to realise that a lot of the girls are going to be running theirs early next year. So I'm prepared to, you
know, run another one next year if I need to. There are some in March in Nagoya, March in Nagoya in Japan. There's Nagano in April, there's London in April. So start to get a sense that that time, whatever time I run in Melbourne isn't strong enough, there is the opportunity to, have another go, because the Olympic marathon isn't until mid-August. So even if I do run a time that I'm really happy with in Melbourne, I may still choose to do another one early next year. I just, I'm really looking forward to running one in Australia. I haven't done that yet, and I've really enjoyed sort of getting to know parts of the course and just preparing in the city where you're racing. It's been a really cool experience up until now, so I hope that continues until race day.
And Jeff, obviously Jess is focused on Rio. Is it a similar story with yourself, or what are your plans? Obviously you're injured at the moment, but...
Yeah, 1500 is a bit different, so we have to run a time and then just turn up to nationals and compete against the other guys that have time and beat them, I guess. So I already have the time for the 800. The 1500, I haven't got it yet, but probably pretty confident I can get that in Europe whenever I want. So I just prepare now for nationals and run well. And
when's
the
next national?
I think it's the first weekend in April.
Next year,
August sometime, aren't they? Yeah. Got to learn how to dance, I think.
I think you already know it.
You said
I did have a picture of that. I didn't put it up.
Very good.
All right. One more question from the crowd, then we'll wrap things up. Okay. Yes.
So at the end of the marathon, when it starts to get really hard, what goes through your head? Do you have any tips or tricks for us of what we should be or might work for us to get us to the end?
Yeah, look, so after London, I worked with a sports psychologist a bit. I found when I came back, I'd been on such a high and went through this real patch of feeling a bit lost and bit of a low mood, and so working with the sports psych really helped me to prevent that from happening again, just preparing myself for that, experience and strategies to, so anyway, with working with the sports psych, I've also worked on strategies for within the race, and he really talked to me about mindfulness and, those times where you're being really internally focused versus externally focused, so associative and dissociative thinking. I think early on in the race, you want to be thinking about being efficient, your breathing, getting into a rhythm, even stride, thinking about, evening out my muscle groups in a sense, like if I can feel my tib ants, like at the front of my shin getting tired, then you're pushing off more and using my calves, just trying to offload areas that are getting tired. And
is that something you do, Jeff?
And as you get into the race a bit further, typically at about 13 to 15 k's in the major championships, I have this real patch of anxiety. It happened big time in London and also a bit in Glasgow, this sudden realisation that everyone's watching me. What if something happens and I can't finish the race? There's so much longer to go, and I have to really control my breathing and just... take my thoughts away when that happens. I'm kind of prepared for it now when I go into races. And I think in Glasgow, I just spotted there were some cows in the paddock or something and just tried to distract myself and actually not think about my body and whatnot. Looking into the crowd when you're starting to hurt, picturing the people that have helped you along the way and, would be cheering for you back at home. Saying little positive things in your head in Glasgow when I saw that the girl in third was slowing and suddenly I realised I might be able to get a bronze medal. All I wanted to do was just start, increasing my pace to catch her. But I knew that, if I just stayed consistent, she was slowing down. I wouldn't catch her eventually. There were 4 k's left to go. And if I sped up, I was risking blowing up myself. So I had 4 words I was saying, and I think I wrote them down somewhere. It was something like, be brave, patient, relaxed. I
actually can't remember, but they really helped me to keep my rhythm, and it was something about being patient and, so I talked to myself a bit, and just always positive talk. I think when you're really starting to hurt, you shouldn't be thinking about what's going on and how you feel. That's where you really want to just picture someone up ahead and have a basic word or song going over in your head and focus on catching that person and don't tune into...
Like about training and all the hard yards that you've kind of done?
That deep kind of thinking would happen more at the start of the race. You turn a bit silly, like you don't... Yeah, your energy's obviously going to the important, the priority, so your heart, your muscles, like brain.
Thinking that I've been here before and I've come out of it.
Certainly. So previous race experiences and reassuring yourself that you felt this way before and you got through it, for sure. But I find that anything too deep, just I can't concentrate. You're really just something as basic as one foot in front of the other. In Moscow it was really hot and I remember just thinking, you know, next foot, next foot, next foot, and trying to be a bit quicker with my cadence rather than like really, being too long in that stance phase. I think you've really got to draw inspiration from anything, and if it's someone that's been a key in, you know, in your preparation, a little letter that you got from from the school kids in Narracourt, they send you little videos and letters, and I'm even thinking of those. You just go Karen McCann and the footage of her winning the Commonwealth Games, they all sort of come into your head and just getting inspiration from any images you can.
I think we might wrap things up. It's getting late. Good luck to everyone who might be training for the London Melbourne Marathon. Jess is obviously an ambassador and running there. Jeff, good luck with Rio next year and
just running on Friday.
Small steps. Really massive thank you to both of you for coming tonight and sharing your experience. A big round of applause.